Thank you. Yes, I'm a domain scientist, how I would be called here, atmospheric scientist at the German Weather Service, but I'm not involved in the operational weather forecast business. I'm co-leading a research group which is funded by the German Weather Service to do fundamental research which will be of relevance to weather forecasting on timescales of maybe 10 years or so. And we are not concerned with, in terms of modeling, what we might be able to do in the future. We want to do research and we use the tools we can get our hands on and the computers and get most out of it. And me and some colleagues, mainly Matthias Brück from the Max Planck Institute for Meteorology, we have been doing some high resolution simulations over the tropical Atlantic in support and inspired by observational campaigns. So one of the motivations, just to show you why we are also interested in the tropical Atlantic, like climate models, it's a long-standing issue since climate models are compared to each other and with observations. They tend to put the inner tropical convergence zones, which you see here in the maximum of precipitation in the tropical Atlantic, too far to the west of the ocean basins. And it's a long-standing problem which never went away with improvements, with higher resolutions. And you see this here in the monthly average precipitation fall for a longer time period. And our hypothesis here is that these biases are related to how we treat convection, which is a very important process in the tropics. That convection in these coarse resolution models is parameterized and it cannot properly interact with its environment. To interact with a larger scale circulation, and our working hypothesis here is that how we treat the small-scale processes introduces large-scale biases in our model simulations. So in the last couple of years, there were a couple of initiatives of measurement campaigns in the tropical Atlantic. It started with BCO, which stands for Barbados Cloud Observatory, which is being operated by the Max Planck Institute for Meteorology in Barbados since roughly 10 years, I think. So they're measuring clouds and cloud-related properties in the trade. So the trade winds arrive in Barbados after crossing the Atlantic Ocean undisturbed for a long period. And then, more recently, there were targeted measurement campaigns, NAVAL 1 and 2. NAVAL 1 in December 2013, which had 8 research flights. They came from Germany, and then to Barbados, and then separate flights out of Barbados, and then again last year in August, so in a winter month and in a summer month. And just to give you a picture here of the observation of precipitation where these measurements were taken. And all these measurements campaigns target at testing hypotheses on how clouds and convection and the circulation interact and how and to understand these processes and what kind of role they play in climate change. In 2020, there will be another international measurement campaign, Eureka 4, from French colleagues, Germans, I think British and American colleagues will be involved, which will again target this area. So then to the modeling part, Joachim already mentioned before HDCP square, and the simulations I was doing would have been not possible if colleagues would have worked on the icon model to make it work on a large number of processes on big machines to run fast. So the ICON model, icosahedral non-hydrostatic modeling framework, is an operational global weather forecasting model at the German Weather Service and also for a regional domain, which it has the capability of local refinement of the grid, and it's for the region of Europe and North Atlantic, it's run at higher resolution online coupled. And in the relatively near future, it will also, the regional model will be replaced by bioregional version of this icon modeling framework. But it's not only a weather forecasting model, it's also a climate model. It was developed together with the Max Planck Institute. It uses different physics, but all the rest of the model is the same, and it has slow extra processes for the land and the ocean model. And it can also be used as a research tool in LES mode. So within the HDCP Square project, it was extended that one can do large eddy resolving simulations with the same modeling framework, with just small changes. And the important part is that you can use this model in any of these configurations for climate weather forecasting or as a research tool, as an LES. But all the capabilities you have from the weather prediction setup, you can have limited area, local refinements, all these kinds of capabilities are available for all configurations. So it's very neat to study how things behave across scales, because you don't need to change your modeling framework, which is always part of the uncertainty when you do these kind of analysis. Within the HDCP Square project, roughly 50 postdocs were working for 4 years in the first phase. Currently, it's in the second phase. And they pushed the model development that it that the model was ready to do really big simulations. And the goal was, to create benchmark simulations for science and parametrization and development over the domain of Germany, what Joachim showed before. So just to illustrate this, that was a setup. So ICON was run at 156 meter resolution, but to reduce the scale jump from the driving model on the outside, it was run basically like a regional weather prediction model, just at LES scales. As a lateral boundary, the information was described from COSMO.DE, the operational regional weather forecasting model from the German Weather Service, and then it was stepwise refined up to 156 meters. And also other models, ICON itself can be used at the lateral boundaries, but also ECMWF data. So, and now back to the tropical Atlantic. We chose the domain basically covering the whole tropical Atlantic from West Africa to the Amazonian basin. And the red region, which is roughly 1/16 of the globe, we simulated 2.5 kilometer. And then within that region, we had a locally refined region, which is still like 3,000 by 3,000 kilometer with 1 kilometer resolution. And the only difference in the setup to the operational weather forecasting model is that we switch off the convection scheme, have an additional prognostic variable in the microphysics scheme, Graupel, for the fast processes. We have no subgrid scale orography and gravity wave drag parametrization, which don't really make sense at these resolutions. And then we ran 36-hour hindcasts for 74 days for the whole month of December 2013, when we had the first part of the measurement campaign, and August 2016, when there was the second part, always initialized at zero UTC with ECMWF analysis. And then we wrote lots of output, hourly 3D output, and 30-minute 2D output. So we were doing this simulation, first of all, in the second phase during NAVA, also to do flight planning. We were trying to do it kind of real-time, that we had this high-resolution information before the flights were taking place, but also later to facilitate some analysis where you needed additional information to do some analysis with the observations. Also for us, we would get targeted evaluation with the, from the observations which were taking place at the place. But also in the second phase of HDCP Square, the project, there will be done again large eddy resolving simulations for that region, and we wanted high resolution boundary data for that region so that we can go back down to 150 meters for a subpart of this domain. And for us personally, in our group, we are interested in convection, how convection aggregates and how the convection interacts with its environment and the large scale circulation, so that we can do all that with the large domain and the high resolution we have for these simulations. So just to give you some visual impressions, you can identify all the features you know from satellite imagery in these simulations. Here I show you the 10 meter wind speed. That's something you don't get in that high resolution from satellite imagery. And you can, if you look closely, you can see the footprint of shallow convection in the trade winds. You can see in this case here was the first hurricane of the season. We captured Hurricane Fiona, the breaking of an easterly wave. From Kármán vortices in the lee of the Cape Verde Islands. The convection within the ITZZ, squall lines over Africa, and organized convection again in the ITZZ. Just to compare with the coarser resolution, so does it add anything in terms of information if we compare either with the operational weather forecast, which is done at 13 kilometers, but we of course grant it to 25 kilometers, or with the climate model, which we run in the same mode. So we initialize with exactly the same data and run it also both configurations for 36 hours, and we always compare after 20 hours, so the model saw the same initial conditions and boundary conditions, and the larger scale shouldn't differ too much because I didn't have much time to deviate these simulations. But even after such short time, you see quite some different. Of course, you see the trades and lower wind speeds in the ITZZ. Doesn't matter how coarse the resolution of the model is. I mean, the climate models do something well. But you see difference, like you don't see any signature of the squall lines over Africa, even in the operational weather forecast at 13 kilometer resolution, and nothing in the climate model. You see difference in the wind speed of the trades. You see even in the coarse-grained version of the high-resolution model, you see a stronger variability from this embedded convection in the ITZZ in this region. Another way of looking at an important part of the inner tropics where the ITZZ is embedded are the doldrums, and the doldrums are characterized by low wind speed, but also by the variability of wind. So you have changing winds from passing convective systems in these regions. And here I compare these high resolution models. So the shading tells you the percentage of time the wind is blowing from the dominant wind direction, compared to the operational ECMWF forecast model. And the doldrums, if you want, is where the wind is less than 70% of the time blowing from the dominant wind direction, stretches in the high resolution simulations all the way across the Atlantic. And you see hardly any signature of or you see any signature in December 2013 from the operational weather forecasts in both months. So you have to change your threshold to really see the doldrums. But we're going want to go a step further. So this is now the data from the locally refined data in the western part of the domain at 1.2 kilometer resolution. And it should be animated. And we use this output data again to read it back in the large eddy configuration and then nest down all the way to 150 meters. In this case, it's a very small domain just because we are in the process of testing the configuration. But it works, and I'll show you on the next slide some preliminary results. So you see, this is a 1 kilometer resolution, only interpolated on 150 meters. And again, when we go from convection parameterized at 10 kilometer to convection resolving at 2.5 kilometer, we enter a new world. If we refine again to 150 meters, we again enter a new world, and you will see it if I start the animations, the very different structures and small scale structures start to form. And we have spent many hours looking at these animations of the simulations. We are looking at the simulations also from the observation perspective, and one way of doing this, we use forward operators to generate synthetic satellite radiances to directly compare with satellite data. A colleague from Leipzig did that here. So he takes the full 3D data, runs a forward operator on it, and derives these radiances, and we wanted to know how well are our simulations simulating the deep convective events. And to do that, we looked at cluster analysis of brightness temperatures in the range of 10.8 microns, where they're colder than 230 Kelvin. That basically tells you a very deep convective system going very high, close to the tropopause. So we looked at this data and compare that with Meteosat on the Severi instrument, which is on a geostationary instrument where you have high resolution, comparable resolution actually to our simulations, and also high temporal resolution. So we really look only at 3 to 5% of the whole cloudiness part, so only the clouds which go very high into the atmosphere. And then looking at that by on different depending on the size of the convective clusters. So and the model is doing quite well if you look at the relatively small convective clusters, smaller than 150 kilometers in size, and still okay if we go to the up to 400 kilometers in size. But the very big convective clusters, especially over the oceans, are missing. We are not entirely sure why that is. That could have different reasons, and we have fixed SSTs through all our simulations. We have allowed only for a 12-hour spin-up. That might have been too short, at least over the oceans. Over the land, where you have where the weather is stronger forced, it spins up much quicker. So these are things. Another point which comes from the from the aircraft measurements, the colleague in France, André Bonin, is doing that. They were dropping drop zones out of the planes when they were flying, and they wanted to derive divergence and vertical velocity from these drop zones. So they flew in circles, and for these circles, relatively small circles, so about 100 kilometers in diameter, they wanted to derive divergence and vertical velocity to characterize the environment clouds form in. So and if we can do that, we can also evaluate the clouds in our models in their proper environment. But the model also has to get the environments right to that this kind of evaluation makes sense. So and at least in the first comparisons, it looks, at least in the lower troposphere, the structures look very similar between the divergence and vertical velocity profiles, which were derived from the drop zones and the simulations in the same point. There, the problem is a little bit that you, in the model output, you only have at certain fixed times, and you have to choose aircraft observations to the at the closest corresponding time. But that is promising, and we hope that we can evaluate clouds in the next step in their proper environment. So, we produced lots of data, and we just started to look at all the data. And we encourage also other people to look at the data. We make it publicly available, and if you have an interesting idea and you want to look at the data, you can dig into the data. But also other measurement campaigns which are taking place now got inspired and how we supported the measurement campaign with our simulations. They're doing similar things now. So I showed you the HDCP square simulations up there before, and these simulations I presented you just now, where we'll do the LES later on. But there was in September last year another measurement campaign, Nordex, with planes in this region up here. They were looking at extreme event and warm conveyor belts. They also perform high resolution simulations for that region. In the Arctic, there's a measurement campaign going on, I think right now even. They're doing also high resolution simulations in a similar setups to us for that region. And together with Chinese colleagues for the maritime continent, and they are interested in the East Asian summer monsoon, we also plan to do high resolution simulations. So to summarize, we have a model which we can use for NWP climate and research and on global to regional scales, and it works at least for our purposes so far also on high resolution and big enough simulations. We performed 2 months of simulations in support of the naval measurement campaign over the tropical Atlantic, and these modeling activities created quite some synergies of these communities, which are in atmospheric sciences often quite distinct, and they don't talk that much to each other, and if they do, there's lots of misunderstanding. But if you do it right from the beginning in a project and you form ideas together, it can help quite a lot. And resolving deep convection, its interaction with the environment, has an impact on the larger scale circulations, but we also in the process of quantifying that more. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Do we have questions for Daniel? No? Sophie? Yeah.
You probably said it, but what do you have as a boundary condition for the ocean? And would the... Yeah, I have the microphone. Would it be different if you had like a coupled system with a fully at those timescales?
We have a fixed SST, and we take the analysis of the SST, which the ECMWF also uses.
And what is the resolution?
It's 9.5 kilometer in August and 13 kilometers in December. They changed the resolution in the meantime. But I have the feeling it can be a problem for something like the spin-up, especially, and how big these convective clusters get. And there's some, of course, some interaction, especially with the more severe events, with the underlying surface. So, or in terms of the hurricanes, we only simulate 36 hours, so I don't expect such a too big impact. But if we want to do longer simulation, I wouldn't be so happy with this configuration anymore.
Okay. Any other questions to Daniel? Maybe I have just one question. Can you say a few words on the computing requirements of these results?
I did the simulation at ECMWF, and the German Weather Service has quite a large contingent of computing time at ECMWF because Germany is the biggest contributor in money to ECMWF, so they also have the right to use a large chunk of the computer. And I used 25,000 CPUs, roughly. The simulations were quite fast. The 36-hour simulation took about 90 minutes, but all the processing of the data around it, especially getting the data, the initial data out of the archive, interpolating it on the target grid, and also for the boundary condition, which you need to provide regularly, that took more than 10 hours, this whole process. So the simulation itself, at least in terms of time, was relatively fast. And then again, transferring the data to DKIR, that took another 8 hours. So for weather forecasting, often the data handling is the bigger constraint than the computing time itself. Also for all our global weather forecasts. We could run weather forecasts at higher resolution, but we cannot handle the data quick enough that it's still useful for the users. So we had the same problem here.
Okay, yeah. So I think that's also an example for this interdisciplinary teams which are working on the same problem. So it's DWD model, Max Planck model, which has been optimized and scaled at DKIZ and then run at ECMWF, and now we need to include the whole workflow environment to even speeds this up. Okay, thanks to Daniel again. There's some more questions?
Maybe while changing?
Yeah. While we are changing the setup.
So your last comment was that you wouldn't be happy with fixed SSDs for longer simulations. Based on your experience with these high-resolution simulations, could you elaborate a bit why that is?
Because the interactions with the surface become quite important, especially if you have with strong winds, you change the mixing of the oceans, you would change the SST, the surface fluxes, which in turn would influence the evolution of your system. Is it a hurricane or just a bigger convective cluster? So on these short time scales, I guess it's okay. And also in weather forecasting, usually it's kept constant for weather forecast up to a couple of days, but then they change to a couple to ocean model. At least that's how it's done at ECMWF, who do also longer forecasts. Does it answer your question?